Hey guys, Joe from Eastwood. In this video, we're gonna be explaining the what, when, and why to powder coating. We're going to cover what it is that you need to start powder coating, how to do it, and what Eastwood offers to make it as simple and as easy as it can be so you can start powder coating at home. Powder coating is the process of using electrostatically charged powder to coat a product. There are plenty of advantages that come with that. Powder coating is a great way to breathe new life into pretty much anything, given that your part can hold up to the 400 degree temperatures required to fully cure. Powder coat is great and has some huge advantages over paint. Firstly, it's more durable, something to consider especially in automotive applications. I'm thinking about stone chips on the underside of a car. It's also more flexible than paint, which makes it perfect for springs, hood hinges, suspension components, and the like. Since powder is baked on, it's extremely heat resistant, which makes it great in the engine bay or on wheels. Powder coating is extremely weather resistant too. It doesn't fade in the sun and holds up fantastically to moisture, keeping your part protected underneath. If you make a mistake with powder coat, you can simply blow it off with some compressed air. You cannot do that with the traditional solvent-based wet paint. Another advantage over paint is that powder coating is considered a green technology that doesn't generate any harmful solvents or airborne pollutants, so cleaning up the powder is as easy as blowing out the gun and sweeping it up off the shop floor. Picking up a fresh bottle of powder is extremely cost effective and will give you the best results, but you can even recycle powder if you need to. Before we get started with how to powder coat, let's go over what you'll need. You'll need, of course, a powder coating gun. The Eastwood PCS 150 or PCS 250 are both great options for the at-home DIYer. The 150 is gonna be the starter option that we offer and shoots powder at 15 kV, more capable for smaller projects. The PCS 250 is gonna be very similar, but the big difference is that it's a dual voltage gun. It allows you to switch back and forth between a 15 kV setting and a 25 kV setting, which is perfect for quickly and easily covering large projects in powder. For more serious applications, we do offer the PCS 1000. The 1000 is going to allow you to dial in your kV anywhere from 10 to 100, ensuring the best possible powder adhesion for all situations. It also lets you change your fluidizing and gun pressure with the potentiometers on the front. But once you have a gun, you'll also need a compressor. The Eastwood Pancake Compressor is a great option for both of the enthusiast guns. While the 1000 here is gonna require 7 CFM at 50 PSI, if you're the professional, chances are you have a compressor that's capable of that. If not, I'll always recommend the Eastwood 3060 Scroll Compressor. You'll also need a simple air pressure regulator, a dry air filter to keep moisture out, as excess humidity can cause problems, an electric oven that's dedicated specifically for powder coat. Now there's two reasons for that. Powder is flammable when aerated, so the best idea is to stick with an electric oven and a dedicated one because it's a bad idea to cross-contaminate with the oven you cook your food in. You'll also need some powder, and Eastwood has a great offering of very high quality powders in every color you can think of, and last but not least, a part you want to coat. So what does the process look like and how does it work? Well, it's very, very simple. The first step is to prepare your part. Remove anything that could be damaged by the 400 degree Fahrenheit heating process, grommets, seals, bushings, and the like. Next, make sure the part is clean, and I mean very clean. Like paint, getting a quality finish all comes down to the prep work. Strip off any existing layers of paint or powder with a chemical stripper, or you might need to spend some time in the media blasting cabinet ensuring that you're down to bare metal. Eastwood offers a variety of different size blast cabinets. If you need one, we'll have one that will fit the size of your job. Once you have your clean bare metal part, touch it as little as you possibly can. Don't touch it with your bare hands. You don't want to introduce any oils that will interfere with the powder. From there, I like to outgas the part. Giving a bare metal part a good heat cycle to release any trapped gases is a great step for prep. We don't want those gases to release while we're flowing out our powder. Also, a good heat cycle will get rid of any charge generated by our blast material. Let your part cool off, give it a good rub down with some Eastwood pre-paint prep. Finally, mask off any areas that are not to be powder coated. Use a high temperature polyester or fiberglass tape. Polyester will give you a nice sharp edge. Fiberglass is a little bit easier to work with as it conforms better to irregular shapes. You can also use high heat silicone plugs to fill any holes that you don't want powder in. From there, you can either hang your part if you need to hit all sides of it. And here's a tip, if your part has threaded holes, throw a bolt in there. Not only will that protect the thread, but it also gives you an anchor point to hang your part from. Remember not to use a wire with an anti-rust coating on it. That will inhibit proper grounding. Stainless steel wire is your best option for hanging parts. Now that it's ready to be powder coated, make sure you get a very good ground, as that's essential to get powder to stick. One tip I have for you guys is to keep an eye out for any body fillers on your part. It's either not going to conduct a charge or it won't be able to hold up to the high curing temperatures, so remove it before coating. Prep work on the gun is simple. Make sure it's clean and free of moisture. Fill the powder bottle only halfway. You want to make sure that there's enough room in the bottle for the powder to fluidize properly. Screw the bottle onto the gun, hook your air regulator up to the gun, and connect your gun to compressed air. Now it's almost time to spray, but first, we have to talk a little bit about safety. You'll see a lot of powder coating videos on the internet where the person spraying the powder isn't wearing PPE. Just don't do that. Always make sure you're protected. At the very least, safety glasses and a dust mask. Now, also, while we're on the topic of safety, we have to talk a little bit about fire. Any fine powder, when aerated, is flammable. So make sure you're in a safe environment while spraying. Turn off anything that's running in the shop that might cause a spark. Never smoke, light a match, or use a lighter near powder. And never vacuum up your powder due to the potential for static shock, and always use a broom instead. Also, to avoid a shock on yourself, make sure you shed the rubber gloves when spraying so you can stay properly grounded. All right, so when it comes to spraying, let's talk about the Faraday cage effect. Faraday cage states that powder will flow into the area of least resistance, which makes it difficult to get into those tight spots. There are a few ways to mitigate this. Hit the tight areas first before you build up a ton of charge, which makes those tight spots even harder to get to. The PCS 250 has an adjustable KV. There's a higher 25,000 volt setting designed for the larger areas. Great for quickly laying down multiple coats. You don't want that for the tighter spots though. Turn that down to the 15,000 volt setting and that will help. The PCS 150 only has that 15 KV setting, so it's a little slower for the large items, but will still hit the tight corners. Now, another thing you could do to help get around that Faraday cage effect is heat your part up a little bit. This is known as hot flocking, and this process is basically just heating up the part and hitting it with powder while it's still warm, which will make the powder stick to even things that don't conduct a charge, but even just a little bit of heat will help getting around that Faraday cage effect. As far as air pressure goes, don't go too much on the air, don't blow powder past the part, and don't blow powder off of the part. Get a nice cloud going and let the static do its thing. You'll get a feel for this, but adjust your regulator on the fly and experiment. So what's actually happening here? Well, when you activate a powder coating gun, the emitter is going to ionize a small patch of air in front of the gun. When you pull the trigger, compressed air is going to flow through the gun and pick up the small particles of powder on the way and blow them out the front of the gun. As the particles pass through the ionized cloud, which is about the size of a golf ball, they pick up a negative charge. This negative charge is of a very high potential, upwards of 25,000 volts negative in our dual voltage system. This type of electrostatic charging is called corona charging. In practice, the ionized particles that now have a 25,000 volt negative charge are searching for an earth ground or neutral potential. This happens to be your part. The grounding clip from our system is connected to the earth ground of your building's electrical wiring and has the neutral zero potential that is required to pull in the powder. From there, spray away. Make sure you're getting a complete coverage on your piece. A nice feature with the 150 and 250 is the clear powder bottle, which lets you see how well the powder is fluidizing and how much powder you have left. Once you're satisfied, place it in the oven at around 400 degrees Fahrenheit to cure. Keep in mind that temperature can change. Always refer to the manual for the powder that you're working with. A good tip is to buy an IR thermometer so you can get an accurate reading off the temperature of the part itself. As the part begins to heat up, you'll see what's called the flow out. That's when the plastic powder particles begin to melt. You'll see the powder become a nice, smooth, even surface. From there, keep the part in the oven for around 20 minutes, give or take. That will vary with powder, refer to the manual, but a few extra minutes isn't going to hurt the powder, so err on the side of caution and add a couple of extra minutes if you feel necessary. Remove your part from the oven, and with its new coat, admire how fantastic your work is. Over the years, Eastwood has done plenty of projects, and they always turn out looking fantastic. Check out this snowmobile head cover that we sanded down to get a nice two-tone finish. The blue metallic is a great contrast from the aluminum letters, and it looks really sharp. Or these white wheels we did for a restoration a few years ago. Chrome powder can mimic the appearance of chrome, but is typically used best as a base coat. These small black Chevy valve covers demonstrate the difference in base coats. You can see one side has a chrome and the other side has a white base under a translucent top coat. You can see that same effect on this blue air cleaner that we've done previously. Last but not least, let's talk a little bit about the process of cleaning up after powder coating. Again, don't use a vacuum for this step as you don't want static electricity to ignite that aerated powder. All you have to do is simply blow the powder out of the gun with some compressed air, sweep up the shop floor, and you are as good as new. Well guys, that is gonna do it. Powder coating is not as complex or difficult as it seems at first glance. If you got any tips out of this video, go ahead and leave us a comment down below. We'd love to hear from you. Make sure you hit that subscribe button if you're interested in more videos like this one. Of course, we'll have all the products you saw in this video today linked down below. And if you do need any powder coating accessories, Eastwood has it all. Head over to our website to see. But guys, that's gonna do it. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Joe. Make sure you keep it right here at Eastwood to do the job right.